Let me invite you on a journey into the late 18th century. In Dresden, Germany, there once lived a clerk. During the day, he was writing administrative documents. In his spare time, he analyzed letters and attempted to define their beauty through mathematics. And he published his work. When I saw his drawings, I was fascinated, and I immediately wanted to engage. My name is Petra. I'm working on this research project since over a year, and I would like to share the current status of my work. The clerk I'm talking about is Christian Gottlob Rosberg. He was born in Döbeln in 1740. He traveled to Hamburg, where he learned copperplate engraving and started to practice formal penmanship. Soon he moved to Dresden, where he lived for the rest of his life, working as a clerk for almost 50 years. At the time, he was well known as a writing master. On the side, he was teaching calligraphy, and he followed his lifelong interest in the aesthetic of letters. In his free time, he analyzed manuscripts, contemplating what makes some look more beautiful than others. He compared sizes, proportions, shapes, finding elegance in rhythm and patterns. His goal was to define the beauty of letters through mathematics. He explained, and I quote, "Ohne gewisse, festbestimmte Regeln kann keine Schrift richtig konstruiert und geschrieben werden. Die Theorie muss auf unumstößlichen Gründen beruhen. Und keine Gründe sind unumstößlich als die mathematischen." In English it means, "Without determined rules, a script cannot be correctly built and written. The theory must be based on solid arguments, and the only solid arguments are mathematical ones." Rosberg published his theory in 1793 with the title Systematische Anweisung zum Schön- und Geschwindschreiben. It could be translated as Systematical Instructions for Writing Beautiful and Fast. This photo is taken in the German Museum of Books and Writing in Leipzig. On the right, we see two large folio books of his illustrations and sample alphabets reproduced with copperplate engraving. To the left are the three typesetted books of the theories which accompany the drawings. His theories are almost unknown, probably because they are quite complicated, but I will break it down to the most essential steps to introduce you to his ideas. His work was mainly with German scripts, which were widely used at the time. He starts his manual by building a fraktur. The base is a simple square. The sides are divided into equal parts. Connecting lines give a specific structure. You can ignore the surrounding script letters for now. It is taken from Rosberg's original illustration. Only the letter A is interesting at the moment. Between AA, we find the most important connection, which dictates the position of the quill. It also determines the width and angle of the tip, and does not change throughout one document. This is not an arbitrary rule. This is essential to his idea of beauty. The line between CC determines the direction and length of movement, highlighted with a blue arrow. Moving the quill along that line generates a shape, which is the fundament for all following constructions. Analyzing this movement, one can see parallels to Gerrit Nordsay's theory of the stroke of the pen. Nordsay refers to this as translation. For curved elements, Rosberg introduces his own unique construction of a spiral. The dimensions are related as well, but for this presentation, I will vary the displayed sizes so I can point out the details as needed. Segments of his spiral, merged with our base shape, provide signature elements. There are several variations, and they can be associated with our modern term components. These components make up the letters. It's a modular system. Here, we see lowercase letters from his Fraktur alphabet, which he published in 1793. I will zoom in a bit so you can see better. One can easily recognize those components in the hook of the C, the dot of the I, and the arm of the R. Let's go back to our base square. We saw that movement along line C gave us our signature components. Now, movement along line D or E will create different shapes because the quill will move in a different direction with a different length. Here, we see three different rhomboid forms resulting from the different movements. Rosberg calls them Gattungen. I will refer to them as classes. So, you can see class C on top, class D in the middle, and the base shape of class E on the bottom. Following this principle for all components gives them slightly different characters. For example, the variant on the bottom is steeper and more condensed than the one above. Assembled into an alphabet, the most recognizable differences appear in the curved letters, for example, A. This is controlled purely by the direction of movement. On a side note, the choice of class which you use depends on your personal preference, giving your writing an individual style. You just need to stay consistent throughout one manuscript. The class can be interpreted as a space localized between the extremes of C and E. Here we see a visualization of how this could be applied to a digital environment. The class can therefore be considered the first axis of a variable font. The animation of these sample letters was achieved with Axis Praxis. Let's go back to our original base square. It has equal sides with the proportion of 1:1. Or we could also say 6:6. Rosberg suggested having three of these proportions, adding 5:6 and 4:6. Changing the square to a rectangle will result in a narrower stroke, because the angle of the quill is steeper. Those of you familiar with calligraphy or the theories of Gerrit Nordsay or Edward Johnson can predict the result. It will generate lighter type. Rosberg referred to this as Schriftordnung, which I will translate to proportion. When we now combine this with our earlier variable, we get a kind of matrix. On my visualization, you can see from left to right the classes C, D, and E, and from top to bottom the proportions, opening a vast playground. I have added the second axis to my digital interpretation. Et voilà, here is our variable font. With this demonstration, I would like to justify my title of introducing the first variable font from 1793. Throughout history, interpolation has been used in one form or another, so the concept was already available. The earliest evidence of its use can be traced back to ancient Babylon and Greece. Around 300 before Christ, they were using interpolation to predict the movement of the sun, the moon, and the planets. In the 17th century, however, mathematicians started to systematically define interpolations. Rosberg didn't announce his system as a concept of interpolation, but essentially, that's what it is. The awareness of this technology was just not as present, and of course, he did not have the nice visualization tools that we do. Rosbach didn't stop with this. He even went a step further. He did not only apply this principle to Fraktur, he designed a family adding more styles in common usage at the time. Courant scripts have a lower X height, simplified shapes, and connecting strokes to speed up the writing process. Remember that the title of his publication implies guidance for beautiful and fast writing. One can easily retrace the connection between the elaborated N on the left and the N written with efficient strokes on the right-hand side. Again, I can refer to Nordseith theories having an interrupted construction on the left and a running, also called returning construction, on the right. The N in the middle combines both. It is an elaborated movement performed in an uninterrupted way. Rosbach classifies it as a separate individual style. He called it Kanzlei Courant. He defined a whole family consisting of several matching styles. This is a composition from him where we see how the styles were supposed to fit together. He is starting with an outline Fraktur, including ornamental filling. In the next line, we have a regularly written Fraktur. It is followed by a Kanzlei script, Kanzlei Courant, and finally Courant for the body copy. Everything is specified according a strict systematic order. I would like to emphasize that the whole system is based on the tip of a quill, not being changed throughout. In other words, angle and moving direction are fixed, at least within one manuscript. Rosbach was not the first one to define letter shapes through mathematics. Other examples are Dürer, who published his simple but straightforward approach in 1525, or the well-known Romain Duras, a typeface for Louis XIV in the 17th century. However, they all modeled their letter shapes with at least slightly adjusted curves in critical areas of the letter. You might be able to identify the tool they originally used, but in the design process, one kind of bends and stretches things to achieve optical balance. Rosbach, on the contrary, stuck to his true outlines, dictated by the quill, with a consequence not seen before. So, why did he do all that? Why did he spend half of his life and all of his money to work on this project? His vision was to define the beauty of letters through mathematics. There was a general agreement that the quality of type had degenerated in the last century. Attempts to revise the Fraktur letters for printing were undertaken by, for example, Campe, Breitkopf, and Unger. They came up with some experimental styles. Fraktur was still the main script used for typesetting in Germany. Influenced by European aesthetics, Antiqua was just coming into fashion, but hadn't conquered the publishing industry yet. However, Rosbach's manual was intended primarily as a guide for handwriting. He created his own tool to improve his teaching method. Students who simply wanted to learn the art of writing were not supposed to go through his detailed calculations. They used tracing paper and practice to copy from his models. Rosbach's aim was to use mathematics to define beauty, and he was convinced that science would prove his concept. He wanted to write the arguments down so everybody can refer to them, and also to prevent arbitrary changes in the future. He probably did not think about variable fonts at the time, but for me, this approach is worthwhile to be taken. I am fascinated by Rosbach's drawings and his holistic approach. At the same time, I am aware that his letter shapes are a child of a century, possibly to be interpreted differently nowadays. In my research, I went through his mathematical instructions to understand the underlying concept, and I managed to redraw all Fraktur letters in AutoCAD, a software which is normally used for advanced engineering drawings. It helped me to build up the geometrics from scratch, using formulas and calculations on the fly. The font is in prototype status at the moment. One of the challenges, just as an example, is implementing stroke width into digital media. The letters A and N as a variable font function as a proof of concept. My aim is to generate a fully functioning font family, including Kanzlei and the Corrent version, as well as the intermediate styles. To evaluate the historical possibilities in an analog way, I began carving my own goose quills and learning how to write according to Rosberg's instructions. It helps me to understand many design decisions done in the past. I would like to thank ATIPi for the opportunity to present this talk and to give a special thanks to my professor, Fritz Meyers, who's supporting me in this research project. I would also like to mention that all of the photos of Rosberg's publications were taken in the National Library in Leipzig. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Petra.